Hello, I'm Guy Herman, presiding judge of the Travis County Probate Court. As judge of this court, I want to thank you for your willingness to be another person's guardian. As you should know, the law places a great responsibility upon you when you act as guardian. Being a guardian is a serious commitment, and you have the highest duty to the person over whom the guardianship exists. It will be hard work, but I know you will find it challenging and personally rewarding.
If you are watching this video, you have either been appointed or about to be appointed guardian by this court. There are three types of guardianship: temporary guardianships, limited guardianships, and guardianships with full authority. A temporary guardianship, as the name suggests, is a guardianship of short duration and limited authority. A temporary guardianship is created only when there is imminent danger to the health or safety of an incapacitated person, or when the incapacitated person's estate will be seriously damaged or dissipated unless immediate action is taken, and the authority is limited to resolve either or both of those concerns. Very few temporary guardianships are created, since several least restrictive alternatives exist, negating the need for a temporary guardianship. A limited guardianship is a long-term guardianship of a partially incapacitated person where the guardian has only limited authority. In other words, the guardian has only those powers over the ward specifically set out in the order creating a guardianship. The ward retains all other authority. A guardian with limited authority may have authority over some or all of the ward's personal affairs and some or all of the ward's financial affairs. A guardianship with full authority is a long-term guardianship over a totally incapacitated person where the guardian has complete authority over the ward except as provided by other law. There can be a guardianship of the person with full authority and a guardianship of the estate with full authority, and these two types of guardianships can be combined into one guardianship. You may be appointed to one or the other or both. As the name suggests, a guardian of the person is responsible for the ward's personal affairs, and the guardian of the estate is responsible for the ward's financial affairs.
As guardian of a ward's property and money, you have extra duties and obligations. As noted earlier, being the guardian of a ward's estate is serious business, and very grave consequences can result if you do not perform your duties properly. As guardian of the estate, you must manage the ward's money, collect and make a list of all of the ward's property, keep complete and accurate financial records, and file annual financial reports with the court. Again, you must manage the ward's property carefully, and the court has a duty to ensure that you do so. Now, Craig Hopper, a local attorney, will explain some of the duties of a guardian of the estate. You may also follow along with your handout.
Hi, I'm Craig Hopper, a Travis County guardianship and probate attorney. I will now provide you with information concerning your duties as guardian of the estate. Also, the handouts you received today will contain the information I'm about to provide to you, as well as other pertinent information. The underlying points to always remember when you are thinking about your duties as guardian of the estate are as follows. First, you are dealing with someone else's money. Second, you are required to show the court what you have done with that money. And third, you should always consult your attorney if you have any questions about the use of the ward's funds. Keep estate assets separate. Keep in mind that you must keep the money and property separate from everyone else's, including your own. When you open a bank account for the estate, the account will be in your name as guardian of the estate, not in your individual name. The account will be connected with the ward's Social Security number and not your own. Never deposit estate money in your personal account. Never mix estate money with yours or anyone else's, even for a little while. Remember that securities must be held the same way that the guardianship bank accounts are held. Interest-bearing accounts and other investments. You can set up checking accounts for everyday expenses, but put the rest of the estate's funds into accounts that earn interest. These are commonly known as interest-bearing accounts. Use only FDIC-insured accounts and don't put more than $100,000 in any single bank. Always talk to your lawyer before you make any investments for the ward. Your attorney will work with you to file any proper applications for court approval. Bonding. One of your duties is to be bonded out as insurance that you'll faithfully perform your duties. The judge shall set the penalty of the bond in an amount equal to the estimated value of all personal property belonging to the ward, with an additional amount to cover revenue anticipated to be derived during the succeeding 12 months. The setting of the bond and its amount are mandatory and required by the state of Texas. The court is not allowed to make any exceptions in setting the bond or its amount. You must file your bond and oath within 20 days of the order appointing you guardian of the estate. Your bond will renew each year, and you will have to provide the court proof that the premium is paid. You must swear on your annual account that the premium for the bond is current. The bond may be increased or decreased by court order from time to time, as the interest of the guardianship shall require. Safe-kept accounts. A safe-kept account is a bank account that holds estate money so that it is not accessible to you as guardian. No one can take money out of a safe-kept account without the court's permission. A safe-kept account is one way to protect the estate. It can also help you reduce your bond, because funds secured in safe-kept accounts do not count as part of the estate that must be bonded. Depending on how much money and what kind of property the ward has, you may want to consider placing some of the estate's money in a safe-kept account. Please consult with your attorney about this possibility. Allowance. Within 30 days of your qualification date, your attorney must file an application requesting a monthly or annual allowance to be expended from guardianship funds for the maintenance of the ward and the ward's property, unless an allowance was ordered at the time you were appointed guardian, or if such an allowance is inappropriate. Investment plan. Within 180 days of your qualification date, you must file a written application for approval of an investment plan for estate assets unless you invest those funds according to the court's default investment plan. Please consult with your attorney about whether such an investment plan will be necessary. Other restrictions. There are many other limits restricting how you can handle the estate's funds. For example, unless you have a court order, you cannot pay yourself or your lawyer from the estate's money, give away any part of the estate to anyone, borrow money from the estate, settle lawsuits involving the ward, selling the ward's real or personal property, or paying your personal bills. Remember that you cannot pay yourself a commission or pay your attorney's fees without prior court approval. If you don't get permission from the court to spend the estate's funds, you might have to pay back the estate from your own funds, and you might be removed as guardian and even be sued by your guardianship bond. Talk to your lawyer about the concerns regarding sales, leases, mortgages, and investments of estate property. You must obtain a written order of the court before attempting to sell, transfer, lease for more than 1 year, or otherwise dispose of any asset of the guardianship. Inventory of estate property. As guardian of the estate, you must find, collect, and protect all the money and belongings that are part of the estate. You must put all property in the estate's name. You must file an inventory and appraisal showing the value of the assets in the estate no more than 30 days after you become guardian. You'll want to ensure that there is enough insurance to cover the property and the risks of the estate. Also, make sure it's the right kind of insurance. Keep the insurance in effect for the property as long as you hold the property for the entire time you are guardian. Record keeping and accounting. You must keep complete and exact records of every financial transaction that has to do with the estate. Use the checkbook for the guardianship checking account to keep records of all money that comes in and all expenses you pay. Keep receipts for everything you buy and anything else you feel may be relevant to your estate expenses. It is very important to keep accurate records because you will have to prepare a report called an account of the following: all money and property you collect and all interest earned for the estate, what funds you spend from the estate, the date of each transaction, the purpose of each transaction, and the estate property remaining after you pay the estate's expenses. Accounting. A year after you become guardian, you must file an annual accounting. In order to renew your letters of guardianship, the court must review and approve the accounting. You'll have to explain to the court why you spent what you spent. Have receipts, bank statements, and bank verifications and other documents to provide to your attorney to show the court. If you don't file your accounting, the court will order you to do so, and you might be removed as guardian. You must obey all state and local rules when you file your accounting. Because Texas law requires that only a licensed attorney may represent the interests of third parties, such as the ward, the court requires that your lawyer give you advice and prepare your inventory accounting and other guardianship pleadings. Closing the guardianship of the estate. A guardianship is ready to be closed when the ward regains competency, dies, or reaches age 18 for guardianships based solely on minority. At such time, you will need to file a final account. Your attorney will work with you to prepare the final account, and the court must review and approve the final account before you are discharged from your ongoing duties as guardian. Being guardian is an extremely important job, and I commend you for accepting the responsibility. However, keep in mind that the court doesn't want you to be acting without any support. Remember that the law requires that you be represented by an attorney during the time you serve as guardian. Never hesitate to consult with that attorney regarding any questions you may have about your role as guardian.
As mentioned earlier, it is the responsibility of the probate court to oversee and monitor all guardianships and to make sure the guardianship is functioning in the best interest of the person for whom the guardianship was established and to see that you as guardian are performing your job properly. I am assisted in this endeavor by court-appointed personnel who visit each ward and by court employees who review the annual reports, inventories, accountings, and other filings required under Texas law. We take this task very seriously and we have high expectations of you. We look forward to working with you over the coming years. Now, one of my staff will go over the time-sensitive requirements for you as a duly appointed guardian. You will leave here today with an approximate timeline of required due dates. Once you have qualified as guardian, your attorney will send you a new list of time-sensitive requirements with the precise deadlines listed.
On behalf of the citizens of this county, I want to thank you for your willingness to serve as guardian of your loved one. I know it's a difficult job. I have been doing this for over 20 years and have monitored thousands of guardianships. I firmly believe that if you will give your best effort, stay in touch with your attorney, follow the rules set forth by the court, you will do a great job as guardian.